song from Delta Squid, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hey, this is Zettel, creator of Imba League and Husky Madness, and you are listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
This is Chan Man V of Wednesday Night Sprites and Climbing the Ladder, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Yo, it's Tempo from IBD Gaming, and you are tuned in to my brother Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Hello, this is Nick Axavranish from Major League Gaming, and you're listening to Sinvicta on SS Radio.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Boogie2988 here, and you're listening to my good friend Sinvicta on SS Radio.
Live on Twitch TV and on the VODs here on YouTube.com, it's SS Radio, 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 Radio. And now, here's your host, Sinvicta. What is going on, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, children out there of every age on there on the interwebs and internets? We are live here on SS Radio number 105, and I could not be more excited to be getting to the monstrous, epically humongous show that we have tonight for you. We have so many things to get to. I've run out of screen space. I literally have two monitors full of information, all dedicated to tonight's stream. We have so many things to talk about. I am so excited. This is going to be the biggest, I dare say, probably easily the biggest show that we are ever going to have here on SS Radio. But of course, an extra special shout out to the Mosh Pit here live on Twitch chat. If you are listening to this on the VODs here on YouTube.com/Sinvicta316, and you missed out on a stellar introduction as well as a whole lot of heavy metal salutes going on in the Twitch TV chat tonight. And again, I thoroughly and cordially invite you to come out and join us for a live recording of SS Radio. SS Radio. It is the show that I do the first Sunday of every month here on my Twitch channel. Just kind of update everyone on what's going to be coming up within the next week with SS Radio as well, with other Sinvicta happenings around the channels, as well as kind of debut new things and talking about some important issues, if you want to go that far. And yes, I am aware that today happens to be August 31st, which is not technically the first Sunday in September, or the first Sunday of the month. But hey, tomorrow's September 1st, so it's close enough. It lines up very, very well with Labor Day for those of us here in the U.S., along with a whole lot of exciting things going on with the fact that this week is going to be huge, and I mean huge here. But before we get to any of that, of course, I'm going to be doing what we always do here on SS Radio, which is I'm going to count back from 3, 2, 1, and then show you the topics tonight and prepare yourselves for the most exciting, it's too hype right now. I hate the word hype. I really do not like the word hype because I think that it's way overused. It's kind of like that word epic. Like, people just overuse the word epic ever since WoW came out, it seems like. And now hype seems to be the new buzzword of the day. But it is almost too hype to even look at. Prepare your eyes, because in 3 seconds, I'm going to show you exactly what we're doing it. So 3, 2, 1, the topics tonight for SS Radio 105, can you believe it? We have my good friend Sparse Vector. He's going to be joining us in just 1 minute. I cannot wait to talk to Sparse Vector, along with giving away. We're going to be giving away not one, not two, but 10 copies of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure and then some. We may even have even more copies to give away in the near future. Sparse Vector comes bearing gifts. It's going to be amazing indeed. And then in the second top, we're going to be talking about Go Plague Monkey Go, which is Sparse Vector's brand new game coming out. It's a game that I've been pestering him about that I've been wanting to play for decades at this point, even though the game's only been in development for like 2 years. But hey, it feels like decades. When you're a huge Sparse Vector fan like I am, it feels like decades. And then rounding out the last portion of the first half of the show, we're going to be giving away 10 copies of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. So for those of you who are interested and have never, ever played the Wagon Adventure before, and you don't currently own a copy of the game, tonight you have a pretty good shot at getting it, because I think most of my subs here on the Mosh Pit do indeed have copies of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. Bone up on your trivia, let's put it that way. And if we end up not getting too many, like most of the people here who already own the game, then we'll figure out something, don't worry. And then the second half of this big show, I mean, it's to a lesser degree, because I mean, Sparse Vector is the spotlight of tonight's show. And then there's some little things happening in the second half of the show. Of course, as soon as the second half begins, I'm going to be officially starting the SS Radio Open number 5 signups. That indeed will be opening up as soon as we begin the second half of the show, coming about in around about 35 minutes from now. And then last and not least, I am going to be officially releasing our public release album party release times 10 million releases. I don't know how else to say it, but the Ward of Lauder, my band, our album Fracture the Fault Line will officially be available for public download. Those of you who are Twitch TV subscribers here in the live audience, obviously most of you should have your copies by now, unless the ones that you didn't feel like downloading it, and that's okay, that's no big deal, that is all right. But for those of you who are not Twitch TV subs, now is your day. August 31st, mark it in the history books that my band, The Ward of Lauder, officially releases the first half of the album. I say half of the album because I'm going to be talking about that later on in the show. But enough about all that. Right back up to the top, I am now pleased and privileged and all kinds of excited to be joined once again for the third time. He's finishing out his hat trick here in SS Radio history. Joining me now on August 31st, 2014, on SS Radio number 105, is the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, as well as the upcoming game, Go Plague Monkey Go. I am pleased to introduce to you, once again, Sparse Vector. What is going on, man?
Hey, thanks for having me.
I am very, very... it's the proverbial excited hat trick. I'm so excited that you're be here. And I also have to say that this is a rare occurrence, but I will give you a live heavy metal salute. Welcome to the Mosh Pit, Sparse Vector. You didn't have to sub to the Twitch channel, but I definitely it's
my pleasure.
It's an honor. So what has been going on with Sparse Vector? We haven't heard from you in about it's got to be almost close to a year now, I feel.
Yeah, just still working on Plague Monkey. It's been a much longer development cycle than I expected, but it's been going really well, and it's been turning into like a bigger project than I originally anticipated.
Well, that's always a good thing, though, because if you're continually innovating and new ideas and introducing new concepts to the game, I mean, that in the end, that just makes a better game for us to purchase and buy and play and, you know, have years and years worth of funds with, I'm sure.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah, it's definitely, I think it's definitely going to be a much better game than I intended it to be, which is always a good thing.
That is very awesome indeed. I am joined by Sparse Vector, and he's also coincidentally the newest member of the Mosh Pit, which is what I call my subscribers here on Twitch. So Sparse Vector, I'm going to let you reintroduce, because I know that we're going to have a lot of new listeners who have either never seen SS Radio or never seen the Wagon Adventure or even know who you are. So I'm going to allow you to have a little bit of time to reintroduce yourself as if we've never heard of you before. Who is Sparse Vector? What do you do? And what are your what are your goals, I guess, in the video game industry?
Yeah, so I'm an indie game developer. My first game was Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, which this crazy person I'm talking to has played more than anybody else, basically. and it's been, I've been fortunate enough to have it be successful enough that I can fund another game, which is Go Plague Monkey Go, which I've been working on for like over 2 years now, I guess, which is kind of crazy. But yeah, I'm just trying to basically earn a living doing my dream job, which is making whatever games I want to make, basically.
That's awesome. How long have you been an indie developer for those of us in layman's terms who don't quite have a grasp on what it takes to become, to develop your own video game and actually see it come to fruition and marketed and that sort of thing? How long have you been doing it?
I've been, I guess, on and off doing this full time since, I guess, August 2012, which is when the first version of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure came out on Xbox Live Indie Games. So it wasn't like it wasn't initially making enough money to live off of exactly, but my plan was basically to use some money from savings to develop another game and then release that, and then hopefully at that point be self-sufficient.
Right.
But I've been lucky enough actually that it's done well enough that I haven't really had to dig into savings yet. So I've been on and off a full-time developer, indie developer since I guess 2012 now.
So it's appropriate then. It's August. Here it is, August, 2 years later, and you are an extremely successful indie developer with a huge boom of popularity of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. And then, if you want to, kind of, I guess also talk about the Turbo update, because, like I said, I know that we're joined by a lot of people who may not have ever played the original incantation of the game. But I guess, how long did it take you to decide that, you know what, the game is popular enough, I better just make like an added-on content, which was free of charge, I might add you. How did you come to that conclusion?
So the original game came out in, I guess actually July 2012 was when the Xbox version came out. Then August 2012 was, I think, the PC version. And then it was out for a while, and it wasn't initially like super popular, but then around January of 2013, like a bunch of YouTubers started picking it up,
Right.
basically, and then it sort of really grew in popularity, and then it got greenlit around this time last year. And then based on the green light, based on getting on Steam, I thought I'd better, not release the same exact game on Steam that I'd released a year ago.
Right.
So that was the point where I decided to go ahead and update the game. And then that version came out, I guess, October 2013, like around then.
And that was, I think that was the last time that you joined us. That was for SS Radio 100, I believe.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Because that was the world premiere of Super Wagon Adventure Turbo, the Turbo Edition. Now, do you still call that Turbo at this point, or is it just kind of, it's melded into just Super Amazing Wagon Adventure without the Turbo suffix after it?
I'd call it, it's basically just Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. I'd call it, I guess, the turbo version, but
Right.
yeah.
So without divulging too much, I guess, how is the game's popularity, how has the game been doing since getting greenlit? I mean, has it really been performing extremely well on Steam since being released officially, or was it not really up to your expectations? I mean, I guess in general, how has the game been producing or performing, I should say, on Steam as soon as it was released officially?
It's been doing a lot better than I expected it to do, given that it was like over a year old when it finally came onto Steam. But it's been doing really well. And then actually, I was lucky enough to be in a summer sale just a few months ago, and that was really huge, actually. That was way bigger than I expected in terms of just the number of new players.
Yeah, I remember sending out all my followers and fans out to vote for it on the I think it was the Community Spotlight sale is how it got voted into there.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yep, I remember that. And congratulations, by the way. That is not something that a lot of people in their entire lifetimes would be able to say. I mean, the game. It's been. It's. I mean, Super Amazing Wagon Adventure has been a staple of everything that I do, on Twitch since I started broadcasting. Even going back to the first SS Radio, which was, I mean, hell, 2 years ago, I guess now. It's probably about 2 years when Sepper and I first started the show. And I'm still I it's still so awesome that the game is still performing admirably, considering its age. It's really weird to say that too, because the game itself doesn't feel like it ages. Like it's not like 10 years from now, graphics cards are not going to be able to produce what we see today on Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. It's almost I honestly think that the pixel art style that you've established for the game is pretty much timeless at this point. I mean, it's not like it's going to deteriorate and people go back 10 years later and say, "Oh, well, that game looks like garbage now." I mean, it's still going to be the same, 10, 50, 100 years from now.
Yeah, I guess that's the advantage of releasing a game which already looks like 20 years old, is it doesn't look any older like 2 years later.
It's got that special that special nostalgia factor, which we all know and love. I, of course, am joined by the one and only Sparse Vector, creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, along with the upcoming game Go Plague Monkey Go here live on SS Radio 105, August 31st, 2014. Now, before we get into the discussion of Go Plague Monkey Go, I guess update Sparse Vector a little bit to you about how I've kind of, I don't want to say I'm more educated in the indie scene, because I'm really not. I mean, I'm barely educated anyway, let alone in something specific like that. But you may or may not have noticed that I've been playing a lot of other games, like, say, FTL and Binding of Isaac, especially here on the channel, along with on YouTube as well. And I've gotten a certain, I guess I've developed a certain taste for roguelikes. And would you consider, because roguelike was not a term that I've ever even heard of until I started playing FTL, I think was the first time I ever actually understood what the term meant. And going back and looking on Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, I guess you can pretty much consider it, would you consider it a roguelike, part of genre of the genre of roguelike games, or do you think it's not quite hardcore enough to be considered that?
I'm not sure. I think it has some elements of that. It was actually when I was working on it, I wasn't even that familiar with the genre. Like the first roguelike that I really got into was Spelunky, mm-hmm. which actually came out like basically the exact same time as Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, or at least the Xbox version came out at basically the exact same time as my game. So I wouldn't really say it's a roguelike exactly, but I think it has some of those elements at least. Like it's definitely trying to be random and it's permanent death, so it has that going for it.
Yeah, and it's still, like, to me, I don't know, I guess I'm a little spoiled because I've played the game so many times. Like, it doesn't feel like a roguelike because I can almost pretty much guarantee that I can win on any run as far as Super Amazing Wagon Adventure goes. Like, there's something that has to go catastrophically wrong for me to not beat the game at this point. That being said, I have a lot of fans, including personal friends, who say that they've picked up the game because of the show and they played it, and it's like one of the hardest games ever. So I guess that in a sense I might be a little bit of a savant when it comes to Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. I mean, I have played thousands of games at this point. And I don't know. Just it feels, it's hard for me to call it a roguelike, but at the same time it has, like, what, as you just explained, like the basic elements, which is it's permadeath, it's sometimes unrelentingly difficult, and you never get the same game twice, which is true, even after playing thousands of times. And I am not over exaggerating that. I have literally played probably thousands of Super Amazing Wagon Adventures over the past, well, since I bought it. And of course, I have to give a nod to my good friend Total Biscuit, TB was the first one who pointed me in the direction of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, because I had never even heard of the game before TB, and I imagine from our previous discussions, the last time you were here, that's when the game really started to gain momentum, when TB, and then later on when the Yogg's Cast covered it on YouTube.
Yeah, that was definitely, he was a big part of that sort of big wave of initial popularity, like back in January of 2013.
He's like the peak. I have TB to I have a lot to be thankful for because of TB, and especially turning me on to Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. But again, it's for me, it's like I suck at Binding of Isaac and I suck at FTL. And I have a lot of people who feel the same way about Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. They're like, I don't know how you beat this game so often. Like, we've had now, I mean, I don't know if you've seen the official Wagon Adventure document, but it's almost up to 200 entries now alone, and that's just in the official races. And it's really funny to see, because we keep track of the actual survivors who literally survive throughout the game without dying, and the number just keeps growing and growing and growing, just because of the fact that it's like, so, like, I'll give you an example. Before I get too ahead of myself here, the last time that we had a complete wipe, I think, was because of the fact that we got, it was the Plague Monkey gun, and I think that person died. In the next scene, someone got tuberculosis or something, then they died, and then I just got chipped away by the desert scene. Like, it's things like that have to go catastrophically wrong for the game to kill Sinvicta. But other people are like, I can't even get past the first, you know, machine gun arm wagon bandit, you know.
Right.
But I will say that I still, even after all this time, I'm still discovering scenes that I've never seen before. For example, the latest part, which had me dying of laughter, was we actually saw someone die from an affliction, and I did not know that was popular, even possible in the game. Because normally, when you get an affliction like tuberculosis or, you know, diphtheria or you know, whatever, it takes you down to one heart. But this one actually killed one of the travelers. It went from four hearts to zero, and I've never seen that happen before.
that's extremely rare. That's probably the rarest thing I think that can happen in the game in terms of probabilities.
Yeah, I saw that and I died of laughter. I could not believe it because I'm so used to seeing like, okay, this is just going to be, you know, it's just going to, we're going to have one heart and then I'm sure I'll find like a couple more health packs along the way. But no, it actually killed the traveler. I mean, I lost it and Twitch chat lost as well because a lot of the fans out there on Twitch have also seen almost as many games as I've played. We kind of get into a routine of the thing where it's like, okay, we know what's going to happen here. We kind of know what's going. There's no real surprises, but every now and then we just get some rare, super rare scene. It's just like, oh man, I was dying laughing. I think it was actually Returo, or no, it wasn't Returo. It was the gamer. Was it the game? I think it may have been the gamer 907 who actually died from it was Mountain Fever, I believe. I guess ask just out of my own curiosity, is it only certain afflictions that can do that, or is it like literally it can be any of them?
I think it can be any of them, but it's a very small probability. Like I think if you have full health and you get the illness, I think it's maybe like a 1 in 100 chance that it'll actually kill you.
Oh my god.
And then like if you have more than that or if you have less health than that, it'll be like slightly higher chance, but it's still a very small probability.
Right. We are joined by Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, going into the second topic here on SS Radio number 105. Go Plague Monkey Go. And I have a myriad of questions I want to ask, but I'm just going to get to a couple main ones because we have so much just announcements to get to today on the program. So Go Plague Monkey Go, for the people who have never heard of the game or they have no idea what it is, I guess if you want to give a brief synopsis as far as what the plot of the game and that sort of thing and the objectives, take it away, Sparse Vector. I'm going to let you explain to everybody.
Sure. So you play as a monkey with a highly contagious fatal disease who is accidentally let loose in a city, and your goal is to basically kill as many people as possible. And it's a top-down 2D action game with lots of random elements. So, like, the city is randomly generated, and the power-ups are in random locations. And it takes a lot of influence from Spelunky and Binding of Isaac and those sorts of games.
Are you going to... I guess going back to the roguelike topic, are you going to consider this one more roguelike than Super Amazing Wagon Adventure is? Or is it still kind of like... It's kind of a mishmash between roguelike features, but also have other elements of other genres.
It's definitely more of a roguelike than Wagon Adventure, but I probably won't call it a roguelike for like advertising purposes. It's still not really exactly, I guess, like a kosher roguelike. Like it doesn't have the RPG elements. Like there aren't any like statistics that you can level up or anything like that. There's no inventory, so there's a lot of things that are sort of simplified or more like arcadey than in a typical roguelike, but it's more along the lines of like the action roguelikes like Binding of Isaac or Spelunky, those sorts of games.
Now, I have put up it's just a screen grab I got from Reddit. I don't know what stage of development the screenshot was taken, but the reason why I keep looking at this particular screenshot, and I was saving it for this, is because of the fact that on a couple of the monitors, you actually see them playing Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. And let me blow up this image really fast just in case if you have the stream open on another monitor there. So I guess if you want to... Just to elaborate on what exactly may have happened in this scene, I guess, and have that go into the gameplay. Because what you're going to be doing in the game is playing as the actual Plague Monkey. You're not trying to stop the Plague Monkey. You are the Plague Monkey.
Right.
And maybe take us through what may have happened in this screenshot.
Yeah, so this is a somewhat old screenshot, but it still sort of is representative, I guess. But this is in the office stage, so you can go into any building in the city, and there are different types of buildings, like the office buildings, parking garages, art museums, like a bunch of different kinds of buildings. And each of those basically are like the levels of the game. So this is in the office building, and basically I think I've killed basically everyone in the office at this point, or most of the people in the office. And you can see a lot of innocent bystanders, like the just random people laying around. And then there's also the guys in hazmat suits,
yep.
the yellow suits. And those are some of the basic enemies in the game. So you have to, because they're wearing suits, you can't just walk up to them and kill them. You have to actually knock them over and bite them. So you can see the little bite marks around the hazmat guys.
I still think my overall favorite screenshot I've ever seen of Go Plague Monkey Go is when the Plague Monkey's holding up the no parking sign. I don't know why that screenshot always just kills me inside. So I guess if talk about how do you win the game, I guess is a good question to ask for the newer viewers who may not be familiar with the game quite yet.
So there is an ending to the game. You basically have to reach a certain number of kills, which is easier said than done. And then at some point, something happens, which basically causes the game to end. And in the game that actually gets released, this isn't entirely implemented yet, but there'll be also a way to loop and play the game a second time, similar to Risk of Rain.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if FTL has that, but it's a sort of a roguelike standard feature by now. But so you'll be able to play it over and over, and it'll get harder each time you play it. But there is an actual ending to the game. And there's also, I'm planning to have at least one secret ending, an extra hard ending.
Right.
Kind of like in The Binding of Isaac, you have the chest, or in Spelunky, you have hell, a sort of extra hard thing to try and get to.
Yep, yeah, and I actually haven't played Spelunky. Dave Chaos from the Augscast actually was, I think he still is a huge Spelunky fan. And the only reason why I even bring that up is because I have actually talked to Dave, thanks to me joining Delta Squid, which is I guess old news by now, with Sinvicta fans. So with Go Plague Monkey Go, how far would you say it is as far as development wise, in percentage, rough estimate, I guess, how close are we to seeing a maybe beta version or an alpha version that that's going to be internally tested and playable for other people with?
Right, I'd say the game is maybe 80% finished. The most of the actual levels are in there, and I'm sort of at the point now where I'm just kind of adding some more power-ups and also doing a lot of polish in terms of making things look better and fixing up the visuals and that kind of stuff. And then I still have to do the Steamworks integration type stuff, achievements and that kind of thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I didn't even think about that.
Yeah.
Are you going to allow, is Go Plague Monkey Go going to be a little bit more, I don't want to say moddable, because me personally, I don't like really playing games that are heavily modified by the community. And I guess a very, very brief example of that would be Torchlight 2. Everyone knows I love ARPGs. I think they're phenomenal. But Torchlight and even Titan Quest I want to use the word ruined, but I don't want to use the word ruined in a way. But I don't know, it just kind of cheapens the experience, I guess, being allowing people to heavily modify the game. Is Go Plague Monkey Go going to support some sort of community interaction where they can maybe create alternate costumes for the monkey or for bystanders, or are you not really planning on allowing that level of creativity and support as far as from people that aren't you, I guess, developing the game?
I'm planning on actually one of the features, which probably won't be in the initial version that gets released, but I'm sort of already planning for, is I really want to do custom challenge runs. So I guess if you're a Binding of Isaac fan, you sort of get the idea of a challenge run. It's basically just a kind of slightly remixed version of the game where you have different starting items or different level conditions and things
yep.
like that. So I was really inspired by that, and then also some of the stuff people have done modifying Spelunky with like the Blue Frog mod and the Froze Linky mod, where they just basically like messed with the level generation or messed with the enemy generation. So I want to have something like that in the game where you can like make your own custom challenge runs.
Right.
Because I think that'll give it a, like a lot of longevity. I'm not entirely sure about like alternate costumes. That's not something I've figured out just yet, but there'll hopefully be some sort of way that people will be able to mess with the game. Like not exactly completely change the way it looks or anything like that, but more just like give them something to do once they've conquered everything, which will hopefully take them a while anyways.
Yeah, and it's interesting to hear you say it because I don't believe, and I'm not, of course, not going to speak for you, but it doesn't seem like we talked about that the last time you were here. Was that more roguelike elements, you know, taking, borrowing ideas from other games in similar genres. Was that something that you decided to go back and re-add, or was it something that you always had planned on? Because I don't remember us talking about that the last time you were here. Of course, that was a year ago. So.
Yeah. I think it was always sort of on my dream feature list, but I don't think I'd done any work on it by the time I talked to you last year.
Mm-hmm.
But now at this point, it's more sort of, it's not, I guess not set in stone yet, but I've done a fair amount of work to try and make it actually possible to do. So that will hopefully be something that will be like in the first update will be some sort of custom run support.
Now, is there going to be any sort of multiplayer support with this, you know, local co-op or online co-op via Steam, or is it strictly just going to be a single player campaign and single player game?
It will most likely just be a single-player game. That's another thing which is sort of on my dream feature list, but that's something I haven't even really looked at adding yet. So unless it's like a huge runaway success and everybody clamors for it, that probably won't be
right.
Something I implement. But it's always possible, but it's not on the top priority list.
I guess the only reason why I asked that is because with Binding of Isaac Rebirth, and by the way, I apologize for bringing up Binding of Isaac so many times, but it just happens to be the game that I'm like completely gaga for right now. You know,
right.
Here I am 3 years later, whenever it was first released. I'm just now discovering I'm Christopher Columbus of the video game world. but with Binding of Isaac Rebirth coming out, they're actually doing something that is a little unheard of, which is going to be doing multiplayer. I mean, the game itself. I believe one player plays as a familiar, and the other player just plays as, you know, whatever alter ego of Isaac, that sort of thing. And if you had to implement that something like that or similar to it in Go Plague Monkey Go, have you left the door open for you to add something like that in the future, or is it kind of just hard coded into not ever including multiplayer for the time being? Like, I guess, in another way of asking it, would you have to completely redo the code from the ground up to add multiplayer support, or are you leaving yourself a little bit of leeway in case if you need to add something like that?
It would not be super technically hard to add local multiplayer.
Mm-hmm.
Online multiplayer would require a whole lot more work, basically. I wouldn't say it's impossible or anything, but it would require like a lot more coding to get online multiplayer working.
Gotcha. And yeah, I only ask because I know absolutely nothing about coding.
Yeah,
you know, I barely did HTML and Java when I was back in college, and I even today, and this is actually hilariously tied into today's show, by the way. So Team Liquid requires you to have a Liquipedia page, which is basically their version of Wikipedia, to have a public tournament listed on their website, which is something I've never required up until now. And anyway, I just learned, congratulations, put the bronze medal of crappiness on Sinvicta's, you know, forehead, that I finally learned how to create a brand new wiki page, and that's my extent of my coding, because coding goes all different. So I can't even imagine what goes into like actually making a game, you know. Was Go Plague and Go written in like your own engine, or you know, what language was it written in, that sort of thing?
It's in C#. It's also using XNA, which is the same thing Wagon Adventure uses. Which is not exactly an engine. It's more, I guess, like a framework.
Mm-hmm.
But it's mostly my code. The C# just sort of XNA just sort of handles like opening windows and like getting the mouse and button input and that kind of thing.
Gotcha. I know that I have a couple of really, really techie nerds out there that are interested in that sort of thing, and Zettel included, because Zettel is the creator of Ember League and Husky Madness and other things. He's a StarCraft II map editor for the arcade, and even then, when I look at some of the files that he sends over, even with like nothing but triggers and stuff, it's just like I wasn't born with a smart brain. What can I say? I cannot handle looking at lines of code. I can't do it. Maybe that's the reason why I sucked at calculus too. I don't know. That might be the reason. Again, I'm still joined by Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, along with Go Plague Monkey Go, the upcoming game. And I have to ask before we go into the Super Amazing Wagon Adventure giveaway portion of the show before we wrap up the first half tonight. When can we see, I guess, in a very general guesstimate from the creator himself, when can we expect to possibly be able to show off a playable version of Go Plague Monkey Go?
My hope was this year, although it's sort of looking less and less likely that it will be that. But if not this year, hopefully early next year. It's sort of at the point now where just sort of finishing things up. And then also, once I finish things up, I also have to sort of look at what else is coming out and try and figure out, you know, like, where is the best, what's the best time frame to promote it and that sort of thing.
Right.
So, yeah, hopefully very soon.
And are you going to be, I know we've discussed this, but just for my own curiosity, are you going to be contacting certain people to give them, like, test versions of it to I guess, do bug fixes or see if there's any maybe exploitable things that, basically it's an alpha test, I guess, of the game. And will that be released any sooner than next year, or is it still going to kind of tie it up into your scheduling sort of thing?
Yeah, I'll probably do both. Like a beta test just for bug testing purposes, and then also there'll be like a more of a promotional, like, press beta kind of thing.
Gotcha.
The testing one, I'm not sure. That will potentially be like a month or so before the actual game comes out, and then the press one, I'm thinking more like a week or two before the game comes out. But yeah, there'll be opportunities to test it and stuff.
Okay, so we're probably about 6 months still away from the possibility of it being ready for release and that sort of thing then.
Hopefully a little less than 6 months, but yeah, maybe 3 to 4 months.
Okay. Well, that sounds great. And now we're going to go to everyone's favorite part. It is my favorite part, but my favorite part is just asking about Go Plague Monkey Go, because I have been hounding Sparse Vector as much as possible on Twitter, with being respectful, of course, just playfully poking that I want to play some Go Plague Monkey Go. But we are now pleased to be able to offer you all fine gentlemen and ladies here on a Twitch chat an opportunity to win your very own copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. We are going to be giving away, I believe, 10 or 11 copies today. It's possible we may not even be able to give away all of these. So here's how it's going to work. I'm going to ask a couple of basic questions about the game, and some of them may be related to the game itself. Some of them may also just be about, like, you know, the Super Amazing SS Radio Wagon Adventure. So for those of you rare Sinvicta fans who actually do not own the game already, thanks to me playing the game so often. And then what we're going to do is we're going to have Sparse Vector pick a winner for who A, gives us the correct answer of the question, and then B is the first one that he sees on his screen. So it's not going to be selected by me. It's going to be selected by Sparse Vector. And again, if we end up having, like, just no answers at all, or if everyone just doesn't want to, I mean, if everyone already owns it, then I think that what we may do is we may hold on to the copies and we'll give them away at a later time and just kind of spread them out from there. So, are you ready to start the trivia portion of the giveaway here, Sparse Vector?
Yeah, let's do it. I see some NL sub emoticons, so
people
right. are getting hype.
I'm a big fan of Northern Lion too, by the way. I'm a recent fan of his, and that's only because of his Isaac contact. So, all right, question number one. This is for one of the Super Amazing Wagon Adventure keys. Again, you can redeem this, I believe, on Steam and Desura, or is it just Steam keys?
These are Steam keys.
Okay, so yeah, so you can, if you do not already own the game, and again, I have to reemphasize that, if you do not already own Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, you can redeem these on Steam, and activate them immediately and start playing tonight. And by the way, I will be sending these keys via Twitch, via the Twitch messages, Twitch inbox. So if you are selected as a winner, check your inbox sometime after the show, and I will make sure that you have those in your inboxes as soon as possible. So, question number one out there for the first key for Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. What is Sinvicta's favorite weapon in the game? And I do know that we're going to have let me get some background music as well, because I have a feeling we're going to have a little bit of downtime. But go ahead and type your answers. Please answer only once. And Sparse Vector, I'm pretty sure he knows which weapon it is. But if not, I will be typing it into the chat window for him, just in case if he doesn't know that. Yeah,
question. I see an answer already. Actually, Major Berg. He answered Hawk, which is close enough.
That's good enough. So congratulations to Major Berg on a Twitch chat. That's B-E-R-G. You are the winner of the very first giveaway here. And again, I am going to be playing some music from my band, The Ward of Lauder. Our album is going to be releasing later on towards the end of this program. So congratulations to Major Berg. Question number two. How many times does the word buffalo have to be repeated before it is a coherent and legitimate English statement? And I know that Sparse Vector knows the answer to this one, because I've asked it before. I'm trying to make these easy so we don't like isolate or alienate people who never watched the show before. And I'm actually going to, let me see if I can pull up a second chat window here, so I can contact the winners.
I'm seeing a bunch of incorrect answers, and then OzzyRocker45 is the first one I see to have it right.
Yep, OzzyRocker. So that's eight times. The correct answer is eight times. If you repeat buffalo eight times in a row, that apparently makes an English sentence that I did not know. And yeah. So again, OzzyRocker. Again, I'm gonna be typing out these names here on the document, just so I don't. Do not lose them here. So the first one was Major Berg. Second one was Ozzy Rocker. Congratulations to Ozzy Rocker, member of the Mosh Pit, as well as one of my moderators here on Twitch. Question number three for the Super Amazing Wagon Adventure giveaway. This one I don't know if anyone's going to know, but I'm going to ask it anyway because I know that we've already had it. Who is the all-time reigning champion of the Super Amazing Wagon Adventure SS Radio show? This person has won. I'll give you a hint. It's 10 times in a row. And again, I'm going to type that in the chat. Knows it. So question number three: who is the all-time reigning champion of the Super Amazing SS Radio Wagon Adventure show?
Oh, first answer I see. Got it right. It is Lucello.
Lucello Angelicar. Congratulations. By the way, if you've already won, please. If you've already won or already own the game, please do not answer. Allow other people to answer. And so congratulations to Lucello. We'll be getting you a key to Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. Question number four. Here for the fourth key of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. What was the code name given to the update after Super Amazing Wagon Adventure went to Steam Greenlight? We covered it earlier on in this show. Just need the code name. You don't have to type the entire title, just the code name. It was Super Amazing Wagon Adventure What Edition. Again, we did cover that earlier in this show. This is for the fourth key here of the Super Amazing Wagon Adventure giveaway.
I see Ultraviolet Fight. It has it with Turbo.
Ultraviolet Fight, congratulations. You will be receiving a copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. That's correct. The code name was Turbo. And what made you decide on Turbo, by the way?
Basically Street Fighter.
it's actually funny. I'll have to talk to you a little bit later, because I borrowed the Turbo name for something that Zeto and I are working on.
Oh, awesome.
and again, I'll talk to you about that later. Question number five here. This is going to be a little bit of a trickier one. Who is the creator and the producer of the music used inside of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure? This might be a trick question. It might not. I know the answer, and I know that Sparse Vector knows the answer. But this one is going to be a little bit harder. I really want to see if anyone can get this one right.
Oh, the first one I see has it right. It's Jive Turkey 94.
Jive Turkey 94. That is correct. It was indeed Sparse Vector. And it was not Sinvicta. No. I am not that talented. Sparse Vector is the creator and writer. How long did it take you to make, write all the songs for the game?
I was just sort of doing it as I worked on the game. So basically just as I went. So I guess the initial release, I took, I think, 9 months.
9 months for, nine oh, months. Man.
That's for all of the game and the music.
And I also have to ask, because I don't think I've actually asked this question before. I think it's the second song. Was that inspired by a Van Halen song, or did it just happen to come out sounding Van Halen-y?
It was inspired by that synth sound, mm-hmm. which they used in that song. I tried not to make it like the same chord progression or anything like that.
Okay.
But it's just sort of that 80s chord stab synth sound.
Yeah, and congratulations again to Jive Turkey 94. You will be receiving a copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. Again, I want to emphasize that these keys that we're giving away right now were provided by Sparse Vector himself, but we also have a lot more keys to give away, which if we don't get through the rest of these, and I also have to wrap up the first half of the show because it's already been like an hour long, and I don't want to keep Sparse Vector any longer. So what we'll do, we'll probably end up giving away two more copies of the game, and then at a later time, we'll give away more copies. How about that? Just because of the fact I want to keep things moving along here. So question number 6 here. And again, this is going to be revolving around a basic general question for Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. True or false? You could be sent to jail in the game from killing an innocent person. And I know that one fan in particular knows the answer to this question. It's a very easy one.
I see XILLER. Ziller.
Ziller, very, very true. And just as a bonus question, this isn't an official question. And congratulations to Ziller. You'll be receiving a copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure in your Steam, or I'm sorry, in your Twitch inbox. So do not go anywhere. Here's just a regular bonus question: who was it out of the members of the Mosh Pit that was first sent to jail after the bank robbery? And again, that's not a winning question. I just want to see if anyone actually knows that. And one final question here to give away. This is going to be the 7th copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and then we are going to move on to the second half of the show. Was it Channing Tatum? I'm pretty sure the first person, I haven't seen this person named yet. No, it was the person I'm thinking of was Damon Ajin. I know that Channing has been sent to jail, but I think that Damon was the first. Anyway, here is the final question for the last copy of tonight's giveaway for Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. And again, I want to thank Sparse Vector. Make sure you thank Sparse Vector as well for providing these keys. We'll be giving away more out probably during this next coming week on all my weekly shows, but I do want to wrap up the first half here. The last and final question for a copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure on Steam. Name two animals that can become zombified in the zombie scene in the desert. There's two specific ones, although I think there might be... Is there three or four possible answers to that question?
Oh, now I have to think.
I'm going to type it in Skype here to see it. I know it's that... That I don't know about that.
I think it's only the first two that you typed.
And that's it.
Oh, now I have to remember. Are there? So I see a lot of answers saying bears. I can't remember if there's any bears, zombie
no.
bears in the game. I don't think so.
No, and I will. I'll even sweeten the deal here. Just because of the fact that I do know that the desert scene that I'm talking about is after the travelers fall in love, I believe. That's the only time
yeah,
that this
yeah.
scene can spawn. Okay. So the only scene I'm talking about is after two travelers fall in love and one leaves to relieve him or herself, if that helps out. And then if people still can't get the right answer, then I'm just going to say, I'm just going to wait till someone says the other animal, because we've seen one of them. We've already seen one of them. I see cow and pig. That's no idea. Not even close. Animals.
A lot of
humans,
people are getting one of the two.
Yeah. Humans don't count as animals, by the way. Is that there's a specific animal, and I believe that this is the only scene that shows up in, right?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
There's a particular animal that only, I believe, and Sparse Vector says, is this is the only scene that this type of animal shows up on. Oh, I see it. I see the other one. I think we'll go ahead and take that answer since Wally Two Toes is that's the one who said it on my screen anyway.
Yeah, I see that. He was the first to get Turkey, which is the other of the two.
Yeah, so we'll take that and Gatecrasher as well. So Gatecrasher and Wally Two Toes, I'll give two copies away to each of you, one each. So yeah, so the correct answer is a zombie turkey and a zombie buffalo. And I did not know. I guess I did know, but I never realized that that was the only scene that turkeys actually spawn in the game.
I think there's turkeys that you hunt at the beginning, but that's the only scene where they actually attack you or anything.
Are there turkeys in the first scene?
I think so. They look a bit different. Like they're not zombies.
Huh. I know they're not zombies, but yeah. So congratulations to Wally Two Toes, who is a member of the Mosh Pit. You have won yourself a copy of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, as well as Gatecrasher for chiming in super late. But he also is going to get a copy of it as well. And Hyena Bones already owns the game. We already know that. So congratulations to Major Berg, Ozzy Rocker 45, Lucello, Ultraviolet Fight, Jive Turkey 94, Ziller, Wally Two Toes and Gatecrasher. All of you will be receiving keys for Super Amazing Wagon Adventure in your Twitch inboxes. And again, make sure if you do see Sparse Vector in chat, because I know he's going to stick around for a little while, make sure you thank him. And any other questions that you may have, I'm not going to obligate him to answer it, but if he wants to, ask him in Twitch chat. He is also a moderator and the newest member of the Mosh Pit. Thank you very much, Sparse Vector. And before we end the first half, is there any other last words you have, Sparse Vector, before we run this half out the door?
No, just thanks for having me on, and hope to talk to you again soon.
Yep, yeah, and I I'm going to be rapidly hitting my refresh button on my inbox whenever you start start giving away press copies of Go Pokemon Go. I can't wait. I am just so, like, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to be posting, like, my high score screenshots to you and just sending them incessantly. It's going to be amazing. So thank you very much, Sparse Vector, for joining me. And like I said, he is going to be sticking around in Twitch chat. I'm not going to obligate him to answer any questions or anything like that. But if he does want to, make sure you at least thank him in Twitch chat. And again, yeah, thank you very much, Sparse Vector. Coming up out of the second half, we are going to be opening up the SS Radio Open number 5 signups that will officially begin when I say it, as well as ending out the rest of the show with the official public release of the Ward of Lauder Fracture the Fault Line album. My band, I am looking forward to it. Don't go anywhere. You're tuned into SS Radio number 105 here on twitch.tv/Invicta, as well as on YouTube. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. Secure your homes. Peaceful collapse. we are back here on SS Radio number 105. And again, I want to thank my good friend Sparse Vector, the creator of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, and the upcoming game Go Plague Monkey Go. Those of you who won a key in the last half hour, I guess I should say the last hour of the show, you have been sent a PM with your keys. And again, those are redeemable only on Steam. And once again, I do want to thank Sparse Vector for supplying the keys. And again, stick around after the show for the very special edition of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure, the SS Radio Show, where we're going to have Sparse Vector, Sinvicta, and Angelicar squaring off against each other to see if Angelicar can brutally murder myself and Sparse Vector, or if Sparse Vector is actually going to win. I don't think we've actually won any wagon adventure with Sparse Vector on it. But moving on here, because I don't want to linger too much longer here on SS Radio 105, but I do have the other big stories to get to tonight. First and foremost, it is time to begin and open up the signups for the SS Radio Open number 5 Gold and Under Tournament. I cannot wait, because as soon as I hit this button, this is going to be live. I'm going to be having one of my moderators, I think it's going to be Sada, who is going to create the link where people can sign up for it. And again, I did send out a couple of days ago, I did send out a notice letting everyone know exactly when the signups are going to take place, as well as the website that we're going to be using. And the website that website is going to be binarybeast.com. And let me just make sure that the tournament is live. It should be live, and it should be able. You should be able to sign up for it now. So the signups have officially started here for the SS Radio Open. This is going to be the Gold and Under edition again. So again, if you are a Gold leaguer or under, and you've never ever gotten past Gold, and you're in the history of you playing StarCraft II, which includes going all the way back to Wings of Liberty, then you are more than welcome to sign up. We have 64 available slots. Slots will be on a first-come, first-served basis. And I've also migrated the tournament rules, which I'm going to briefly go over really, really fast, because I know that a lot of people are indeed going to have that, or have questions regarding that. So once again, the SS Radio Open number 5 is officially ready to go for signups. So sign ups here. And again, if you are watching this live on the archives here on YouTube, then I will be posting the sign up link down below along with the copy of the rules. And I'm going to go over some of the rules briefly here. Tournament rules. Now, I'm going to wait a second for Twitch chat to get caught right back up, and then I will be going over some of the rules, because it looks like a ton of rules on here, and there really isn't. But I do want to cover some of the basics about what we're going to be having for this tournament. Again, I know that we're going to have a lot of new faces and new players who have never experienced an SS Radio Open before, and I do want to make sure that I kind of ease them in, because there are certain rules and regulations that we do have to talk about here. But again, the signups are officially live. I'm going to be tweeting out as soon as we're done on Twitter, as well as on Facebook, to let everyone know that signups are officially live. But those of you listening live right now, you have a leg up, because you are more than welcome to join. Again, you do have to have a Binary Beast account. Zeke.com, which is the website that I was using, they actually shut it down in May, which is the reason why I had to move things over to Binary Beast. Again, this will be an official Team Liquid event as well. And again, shout out to Team Liquid for allowing me to do that after I figured out how to make the wiki page. So I'm going to briefly cover most of the most important rules here on the rule sheet. And again, if you are listening to this live, please follow along. If you're listening to this on YouTube, then I encourage you to follow along as well. Check the link down below in the information box. That will take you to not only the sign-up page, but as well as the rules page. And again, I am going to be going down in order, just briefly explaining some of the rules, not all of them, because I don't have that amount of time. But I will cover the basics. So this is going to be a 64-player tournament. It is on a first-come, first-served basis. Gold and Under means that you cannot ever have been past Gold League in any season. That includes going into Wings of Liberty. If you are on account, if you happen to be, like, say, Bronze League here in Heart of the Heart of the Swarm, but you were once a Platinum Leaguer in Wings of Liberty. I'm sorry you're not going to be eligible. Again, we will be having people actively looking at your profile to make sure that you are that is legitimate. Now, one of the biggest things that I will say before we go any further is that traditionally how the rules have been upheld in SS Radio Opens have been by the players. I encourage the players to police themselves. I am going to have some admins available. I'm not going to have as many admins as has been historically available for these tournaments, but I will be having admins, but they are not going to be expected to police everyone out there. So, for example, if you are eligible for signing up, and if you've signed up, and let's just hypothetically say that today is the day of the tournament, it is your responsibility to look at your opponent, find out exactly, hey, has this person ever been gold or higher or not? If you end up starting the game, playing it, and find out after the fact it's too late, that person will be disqualified, but you will not be granted a forfeit win. If you play the game, you are accepting all responsibilities that happen in that game. So again, I encourage all players to police themselves. It is your responsibility, not the admin's responsibility, not my responsibility, to check out everyone that you play. So you want to be sure whenever you meet up, everyone's going to be meeting in the Sinvicta group chat on the North American Battle.net server. And when you find your opponent, you guys and gals talk it out with each other. You can check them out on their public profile. Just right-click their name, go to their profile. If you see a lifetime 1v1, this is strictly for 1v1, 2v2, 3v3, 4v4 don't count. It doesn't matter if they're Grandmaster in 4v4. As long as their 1v1 shows that they have never been past Gold League, we're good. But again, make sure you check out their profile. That is your responsibility as the player. The admins will uphold rules, but they will not actively do background checks, let's put it that way. So that's the biggest thing. Now, with that being said, moving on. The tournament will begin officially at 2 p.m. Central, 3 p.m. Eastern, and which is noon Pacific, this coming Saturday in about 6 days from now on the 6th of September. We're going to be having a 15-minute beginning opening ceremony, festivities, that sort of thing, and then around 15 minutes after the tournament starts, we are going to be hopping directly into competition. We're going to be having four live streams and casters who are going to be doing the commentating. It's going to be myself, my brother Tempo, Mr. Bigface, and Returo as the fourth caster. And again, all four of them will have their own Twitch chat. All four of them will be streaming it and casting it live. And again, if you are familiar with the production level that we do post, or that I do use in the in SS Radio tournaments or SS Radio Open tournaments, then it's not going to surprise you. But we do I do take a very, very a big stance of pride when it comes to the production qualities. You must have a placement in the 1v1 league of this current season. I did see a question come about that a while ago asking, do we need to be ranked in 1v1 or can we just sign up? No, you must have a division this season in 1v1 in order to be eligible. And then, only then, can we look at your history of highest leagues that you've ever finished in. Now, what's going to happen on the day of the tournament? Let's say that today is Saturday. We're ready to go. Everyone is going to meet up in the Sinvicta group chat that is on the North American Battle.net server. You're going to meet up there. Find your opponent. The brackets will be listed on the Liquipedia page. All those will be dictated by BinaryBeast.com. And then one of my admins is going to go back and fill in on the Liquipedia page. But the brackets, the ones that you have to be aware of, will be shown on BinaryBeast.com. If they're not, then we'll use the Liquipedia one. But the Binary Beast, this is the first time I've ever used the website, but so far, so good. It looks like a pretty solid site. So you're going to find your opponent. Everyone's going to start out on Alkalon Waste. That is kind of a tradition that we have. And from there on, you're going to play the round of 64 all the way up to the end of the round of 32. All of those will be 1v1s, best of ones. And then starting with the Sweet 16 all the way up till the end of the Final Four, those are going to be best of threes, and then the Grand Final is a best of five. But for the most part, a lot of you will be starting on Alkalon Wastes. After that, we switch up in the round of 32, I believe. We are going to be starting on, I believe, Metalopolis is the map, and I have to go back and look in that. But just know that the first map that everyone, regardless of where you are on the bracket, everyone in the round of 64 is going to start on Accolon Wastes. And again, that is just kind of a tradition of mine. But we're not going to start every round on Accolon Wastes, just the first round on that one. And again, like I said, make sure that you do have a 1v, make sure you do have a 1v1 ranking of this current season, and also make sure that you've never gotten past gold or higher. Again, this is the reason why I'm letting everyone know it's gold and higher, or it's gold and under. I'm sorry. We do this for a reason, because we want to make it fun, but I also want to appeal to the lower level leagues in StarCraft 2 to promote gameplay down there and just to give everyone a good show. And again, I want to thank all my casters and admins for that, for helping us out on that one. So a couple other things to go over here. I'm just going to scroll down and just go in chronological order. First come, first serve. If you don't sign up by the time the signups end, which are going to be, I believe the signups close at midnight on this Friday, this coming Friday. Then I'm sorry, you're out. If we happen to not have a full roster on that one, it's possible that we may be able to add you in. I don't know how Binary Beast goes, but just know that it's first come, first serve. You need to create a Binary Beast account and sign up for it immediately if you are interested and if you qualify. If you are unranked, make sure that you are currently ranked. I already talked about that. All winners, and this is a mandatory, all winners must submit winning replays to the tournament website. That means that if you win, it is your responsibility to submit a replay. You can upload the replay file up to binarybeast.com. If you need instructions how to find a replay file, you can easily just open it up. Go to your replay, the replay menu inside of StarCraft 2 itself. Right click, say go to directory or something like that, or open directory, and it will take you directly to the Windows directory, where then you can upload it to binarybeast.com. All winners are required to do this. If you win and you do not upload a winning replay, and assuming there's no technical issues or that, you will be DQ'd. Your opponent will not be given a win, but that's just going to be a blank bracket. So make sure you pay attention to that. If you have questions about that, ask them in chat. Ask them on the YouTube video that I'm going to be releasing later on this week, and we will try to help you out as best we can. But it's fairly straightforward on that. And again, all that is very standard for online tournaments. All players are race locked, which means that you have to declare your race from the beginning of the beginning of the tournament. That is that. There is absolutely no race switching. The only exceptions are random players. Obviously, they're probably at least going to be random. Randomly switching races. But if you declare yourself as a Zerg player, you cannot play Protoss one round. Or even if you get to, like, say, the final four, you cannot just decide, oh, well, I'm just going to play Protoss for a game. You are race locked. And again, that is pretty standard in all major tournaments. All players must check in within 60 minutes of the tournament deadline. We're going to be a little bit lax on that one because I don't know how check-ins work on binarybeast.com. But let's just say be ready to go by 30 minutes before the tournament starts. That's going to be by 1:30 Central, which is going to be 2:30 Eastern and 11:30 a.m. Pacific time on this coming Saturday. You must play the account that is registered to binarybeast.com, meaning that if your name is Sinvicta, then the name on Battle.net better be Sinvicta, because that's what you signed up for on binarybeast.com. If it's not, you will be disqualified, no questions asked. There's no exceptions to that, absolutely none. Make sure your binarybeast.com login name matches your Battle.net one. If you have a preexist.com account and you know that it doesn't match the Battle.net one, you need to send me a message via Twitch. Let me know right now, because if you don't, you're subject to be DQ'd. If your opponent says, hey, this guy's name doesn't match the one that's on binarybeast.com, one of our admins will take a look at it. You'll be DQ'd. End of story right there. So this is your chance to let me know. But above all else, make sure that your login name for Binary Beast is the same as your Battle.net name. So if your name is Sada, make sure you make your name on binarybeast.com Sada, et cetera, et cetera. It is the player's responsibility to report another player to a tournament admin if they suspect that their opponent has played a different race. Again, that's all about the player policing policy. It is not my admin's responsibility. It is not my responsibility to personally check out every single participant. It is your responsibility. So again, keep that in mind. You are expected to police your own matches. If you think something shady happened, then we'll get the admins involved. But if you're playing against a Protoss and you know for a fact that this person in the previous round declared as a Terran player. You need to bring it up with a tournament admin. We'll check it out, and trust me, my admins will handle it. That's what they're there for. But they will never, ever do this automatically. It is your responsibility to bring it to their attention. Again, my admins will be standing by, and they will be able to help you. We are on your side, but you have to make sure that you know to contact us. Don't expect us to be able to police it, because we're leaving it up to the players. And then the other, as far as the disputes and all that sort of thing, anything shady that you think may happen, if you just somehow believe that this player is not a gold leaguer and you find out that, hey, he was a diamond leaguer, but you find this out after the match played, they're going to be disqualified, but you will not move on. You accept responsibility, and you agree to the terms based on when the game started. So if you accidentally went up against a diamond player and you didn't call out anything before the game started and you did this after the fact, it's too bad. You will not be moved on. It counts as a loss. That person will be DQ'd, and that's that. We've had issues before, people saying, oh, this guy was just too good, that sort of thing. If something like that happens, bring it to the admins. We'll take a look at it, and then we'll make a ruling on that, and all decisions there are also final. The map pool is super-duper easy. We only have 7 maps. It's going to be Akalon Waste, Neoplanet S, Metalopolis, Shakura's Plateau, Ohana, Yeonsu, and King Sejong Station. That is it. We have a lot of old maps making a comeback. And again, this is something I talked about in Speedcraft as well as Friday Night Fan Fights. I did this on purpose to reintroduce some of the best maps from previous StarCraft to tournaments, and yeah, if you're not familiar with those, you can play them right now, and you can definitely check them out and play them on your own time. Any other questions, you can always ask me. You can send me a PM or leave it down below here in the comment section on YouTube, and I'll try to answer it as best as possible. But again, these signups are now officially live. You are required to have a Binary Beast account, and again, that will be starting at 2 p.m. Central, 3 p.m. Eastern, and 12 p.m. Pacific Standard Time this coming Saturday. It's going to be amazing. First come, first serve. Get signed up and get ready to have a lot of fun for the SS Radio Open number 5. Moving on to the last and final topic tonight. I know this is the day that a lot of us have been waiting for, myself included. I need to rehydrate real quick, because my voice is still not in a good place. But it is now time to release my band's album, The Word of Lauder, which is the name of my band, Fracture the Fault Line, is officially released publicly. Previously, for those of you who did not know, it was only available for Twitch TV subs and only available for people who opted in to download that. Now is officially open for everyone. I'm going to be releasing the video right now, actually. And apologies if you do hear a little bit of a YouTube echo. I just need to make sure that I get this sorted out here. You shouldn't hear an echo, because I've muted the Chrome chat and the Chrome audio. But I am going to be releasing that. And in just one second here, Twitch chat, I will paste the download link for you all. Today is the day. My band's album is now officially released. And anyone out there who can't wait the extra 2 minutes for me to paste this in Twitch chat, you can go to YouTube right now, and it will be live. There you go. Fracture the Fault Line has officially been released. There you go. The video is live. The download link will be made available here in Twitch chat in just 1 second. I just need to let everyone know that the album is officially live. And once I do that, we will be talking about it and then wrapping up the show. And again, I do want to thank Sparse Vector for joining us. And also, make sure if you do see him, make sure that you thank him for providing you with so many copies of Super Amazing Wagon Adventure. And again, I am going to talk about it and give everyone a little bit of a retrospective, as well as talk about the future plans for the band here. Let me just add this to the channel trailer. This is the first time I've changed the trailer in quite a while. The unsubscribed trailer, I should say. So change it. There it is. Boom. There we go. It is released. Let me go ahead and copy the link here So everyone has it on Twitch chat, and then I shall be chatting with you all just a bit before we wrap up this show here tonight. So download a link here. Go, 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 go. There you go. So it is officially released today. Amazing, amazing. What a journey it has been, and I am so, so happy and fortunate to be sharing it with you all here. It's been a long time coming. Again, there's going to be some questions about how to actually open up the zip file, and I'm going to talk it through with everyone before we wrap up tonight's show. So, here's how it works. And again, for those of you watching this on YouTube, I will be pasting the download link down below here as well for those of you who have not already seen the channel trailer and have not downloaded yet. So, when you go to the MediaFire link, first and foremost, I am not affiliated with MediaFire at all. If you see any ads, don't click on them. Again, I don't know where they take you, and I reiterate that I am not affiliated with MediaFire anyway, and I do not recommend ever clicking on any ads that you might see on that website. I only did this out of necessity once a MediaFire, but I will explain what you need to do. So, you go to the link, download the zip file, and once you do that, you're going to see two zip files within that zip file. One zip file is going to say album and lyrics, or something like that. The other one is going to say EULA. Now, what the EULA is that is going to be a zip file that you can open up immediately. The album one is going to be protected. So, where's that password? Well, if you open up the EULA zip file, you will find the password located in there. And there's a very good reason why I had to do it this way. This was done, again, out of necessity. For legal reasons, again, just to protect not only myself, but the band, and as well as my IP, I had to do some sort of agreement just to kind of let everyone know exactly how I wish the music to be used and how I want it to not be used. And all that, again, is spelled out as plain as possible in the EULA. I also give everyone a personalized message inside of the document. Just kind of overall, just giving you the layman's terms of the end user license agreement, which basically says you can use these tracks for whatever you want. You just can't use them to promote anything without my permission. You cannot use them for promotional material as far as advertisements or sponsorships or any sort of video like that. That has to be run through me and only me. And you can do so by emailing me at sinvicta316@gmail.com. All of it is inside of the EULA. But people wanting to use it for PvP montages or whatever, they can use it for a podcast intro, whatever they want to do on YouTube. You can monetize that, no problem at all. I made this album so I could share it with everyone without having to charge them money for it, and you don't have to worry about a copyright strike or anything like that. You get some kick-ass heavy metal that you can use for whatever you want. But there are limitations. As far as like remixing goes, if you want to remix a song, you have to get my permission for it, and I have to be able to hear exactly what's going on. I'm not going to oversee the project, but you cannot publicly release it without my permission. If you want to use this for any sort of promotional material in reference to things that have to be purchased, or advertisements or sponsorship videos, all that has to go through me. But if you're just somebody who wants to use any of the songs for, like, say, an opening intro for your stream, or if you want to use it for a World of Warcraft PvP video or anything like that, you may absolutely do so, and you are absolutely 100% able to monetize it. I'm not going to be coming after you for using it. That is what they are there for. I wanted to make this album with that reason in mind. Is I wanted to do something that I believe has never been done before. And I'm going to go here as we close out the last 10 minutes of the show. But what I will say is this. Today is a long time coming. It's 3 years in the making that I first got the idea that, you know what, I wanted to bring something special, something that's never been done to World of Warcraft PvP videos, which is where the name comes from. Lauder is the name of my protection warrior that I used in PvP and that I still do use in PvP in World of Warcraft. Many, many moons ago, I decided to randomly just make a PvP video, and just because I've always wanted to do that. I've seen a lot of good PvP videos. I've seen a lot of bad ones. I tried my hand at it, and my first video movie, I guess, was Lauder 1, Indestructible. That was my first official one. I did a trailer for it, which was terrible. But Lauder 1 came out, and it was way more popular than I ever imagined. The site admin for WarcraftMovies.com is a gentleman by the name of Uzbeki, and he actually sent me a PM and is just saying that he really, really loved the movie. He hopes that I keep doing him. I can use his website to promote it, that sort of thing. And it just kind of grew from there. And eventually I saw the big copyright beast. I saw that stomping along in the distance. I knew that one day I'm probably going to have to face worrying about copyright here on YouTube, because I was simultaneously uploading the movies on YouTube as well as on WarcraftMovies.com. And eventually I came up with the idea. I said, you know what, it's always been one of my lifetime dreams to write and produce a heavy metal album made entirely of my music. And I wanted to do something that, as far as I know, has never been done before. I cannot recall anyone who's ever written a heavy metal album for the sole purpose of World of Warcraft PvP videos. Like, I've never, ever heard of that, ever. So I talked with some high school friends of mine who used to be in a heavy metal band, and they're extremely talented, way more talented than I ever would be. And we got to talking, and eventually we started work on Thrive. After Thrive was done, that was just going to be it. I was not going to be I was going to use Thrive over and over again, and then make one big epic final Lauder movie, and that was it. Well, by that time, the Ward of Law episodes started to really gain traction on YouTube and WarcraftMovies.com. And I said, you know, I felt at home being inside of the recording studio. Like, that's just where I wanted to be. And I decided that right then and there, I'm going to start saving my money, because I was still working a real job at that point. I was going to save my money, and I want to do something that's never been done before, that I know of anyway, which was going to write an entire heavy metal album for the sole purpose of using it just for my videos. I wasn't originally planning on sharing them, like, publicly, but I was just going to use them, my band, for my videos, that sort of thing. And then it started to evolve into, well, hang on a second. How about we write some amazing songs, and I let everyone use them for whatever they want to do. I was seeing no-name bands come up through the music used by World of Warcraft PvP authors and that sort of thing. And eventually I decided that this is the way I wanted to do it, and I wanted to do something like do a full-length album, which is exactly what we did, kind of. We have a halfway full-length album right now. The first half of the album is officially available. We're calling it Fracture the Fault Line, and it's the first 5 tracks off of what's going to be a 10-track album, if you will. That's the second half is going to complete the album. So I am extremely excited and very, very, very fortunate to be in the position now. Here I am 3 years later, where I don't have to worry about talking to just 10 people on Twitch or 5 people on YouTube. You know, I have tens of thousands of people that I can talk to, and I can crowdsource and ask, you know, hey, do you like this song? What do you not like this song, etc. It's two dreams coming together, really, is what this album is. And moving on to the future, before I wrap up the show here, there is a contribution/donation link located inside of the EULA, should you want to do that. You're not obligated to. Again, as always, all of it is completely and absolutely free of charge. I will never, ever, ever charge for anything that I do, as long as I am able to do that. Let's put it that way. But I will say this, that any funds that are generated from donations and contributions coming from the first half of the album, all of that, 100% of that goes into funding the second half of the album. And I've already received some very kind donations from older members of the Mosh Pit who've had the album for quite a while now. But there's also something else that I'm going to be talking with to you. This is the first time I've publicly talked about this anywhere. I'm highly considering exploring the possibility of possibly doing a Kickstarter-like project to help fund the second half of the album. I have to say that I was inspired by Lethal Frag and his the amazing amount of success that he had in his pinball experience campaign is really what put me over the line, because I was already kind of thinking about it, but I never talked about it with anyone publicly anyway. I've been discussing this for a while now with the guys in the band as well as some other people, but I've never actually divulged in publicly talking about it. And this isn't a public declaration yet, but I am considering also possibly doing some sort of a crowdfunded Kickstarter campaign to fund the second half of the album. And in conjunction with the contributions that have already been made and that will still continue to come in from the direct PayPal link in the inside of the EULA. Now, one thing that's going to be neat about this, and again, theoretically, I don't know anything about Kickstarter. All I know is that the only time I've ever used Kickstarter was for Lethal Frag. That was it. But theoretically, how I envision this going is I will be reducing the goal if I can. I don't know if Kickstarter allows this, but direct contributions from the PayPal link located inside of the first half of the album will go towards lowering the production costs for the second half of the album, if that makes sense. And I'm not I'm not comfortable with letting everyone know dollar amounts and that sort of thing yet. But let's just say that, everyone knows that I did personally fund out of my own pocket and savings the first half of the album. That includes the production cost. That includes, you know, paying for every. That's just production cost. I mean, that's all. It's everything. It's recording, writing, you know, brainstorming, paying members of the band, that sort of thing. All that was funded through me. I wish I could do that for the second half. I really, really do. And in some way, I kind of feel like I've let myself down in that regards because I didn't want to have to rely on getting generous contributions from fans, that sort of thing. That's not what I wanted to happen. But over time, you know, especially since the fact that I don't even have a fraction of what I used to make as far as my old real job goes. And if I want to complete this dream, to complete this album of mine and get more music out to everyone out there, this is looking more and more realistic. This is pretty much a cause of necessity at this point, where I'm going to have to ask for help and that sort of thing. So again, I'm not officially declaring anything yet, but this is probably what's going to happen, is that direct contributions that come in from the first half of the album will directly start to lower the goal for the crowdfunding operation whenever that happens. That way, there's two channels that can come together to help us finish funding the second half of the album and pay for it and get it recorded and finish the entire album. I don't know what we're going to – we have no song names. We haven't even started writing for it. Production and all that stuff will begin as soon as it's fully funded. Let's put it that way. So that's all I can say. And again, from the bottom of my heart – and this is no longer Sinvicta. This is Brad that we're talking about. This is myself. My name is Brad, or Bradford, however you know me. I want to personally thank everyone out there who has ever listened to the show, listened to my music. I should say our music. I own the music, but it's not my music. It's everyone's music. I want to thank everyone who has continually supported my content, not only on Twitch but also on YouTube. Without that sort of support, none of this is possible. And you know, and I'm not ready to say that I've made it, because I certainly have not made it. I am not Husky. I'm not Krendor. I'm not Jesse. I'm not TB. I'm Sinvicta's nobody. But eventually, everyone has to start a. There is a momentum that is built when you're starting out in this industry, and to be over that first hump is amazing. Like, that is like tear-jerkingly awesome, amazing amount of support. And I would have never, even a year ago, I would have never dreamed that here we are today, releasing the album, releasing you know, talking to new fans, new viewers that I would have never dreamed of having a year ago, that's unbelievable to me. And I want to do this for as long as possible. You know, reality aside, I don't do this for money. But you also require money. And again, I'm not going to go into the money rant because I've already ranted long enough anyway. But money aside, I wish I did not have to worry about funding the second half of the album. It's something that I really had to come to terms with, but the reality of it is that I personally cannot afford. If I went by my own funding for the second half of the album, I would not be able to. It would just not come out because if any of you saw my paychecks, it is laughably pathetic. And again, the only reason why I'm able to even do this right now is because of my living situation, taking care of somebody in the family. I don't have a whole lot of bills to pay. It's doable. I'm working with what I've got, and the fact that I've come this far so far is unbelievable. Like the odds of that happening a year ago, 2 years ago were slim to none. I did not think that this was going to be possible. So I do want to thank everyone out there on YouTube as well as on Twitch who have stuck with me since the Lauder days. And I know that we've come and gone. We've lost some fans. We've gained some fans. Changed directions of the channel, changed directions of not only YouTube but on Twitch as well. But it does it means the world to me. And the one person, if I have to thank one person in everything here before we wrap up the show, the only person who put me in this position to be able to do this is Mike. Without Mike, Sinvicta would not exist. And that's why I owe Mike everything. And he knows that, and I work with him, help him out, that sort of thing. And that's the reason why we're such good friends, because I know I will never ask of him for anything, and he asked me to help him out with it, and I'm more than happy to. But other than Husky, the community that we're building on YouTube and especially on Twitch, because we're getting new subs and new viewers. We have something to build on now. That's not something that we could have said 2 months ago, a year ago. And the fact that we're here now and we have a foundation to build on going forth from there, help me not only me reach my goals and dreams, but also sharing it with every one of you here in on Twitch and on YouTube is not something that I would have thought possible. And it definitely is an honor for me to do that and to continue doing that. And I'm looking forward to bringing you all more and more entertainment and more fine series and also all-around bad gameplay, because Lord knows Sinvicta is just awful at pretty much any video game that he plays. So, again, I'm speaking not from Sinvicta but from Brad. I want to say thank all of you and thank you all for helping me and supporting me through all this. And I am excited about doing the second half of the album. I'm excited about continuing what we do here on Twitch as well as on YouTube and moving forward. As long as I can do it, I'm going to do it until I die of starvation, which actually I probably could use right now because I could drop a few pounds. That's for sure. If there's one downside to doing new media is the fact that this is the most out of shape I've ever been ever in my entire life, which is, so those of you who know me personally, it's quite sad. So again, thank you very much, everyone. Do appreciate it. I want to thank Sparse Vector for joining me here as well as this really, really freaking long extended edition of SS Radio. And again, I do want to thank everyone. Enjoy the album. Please let me know if you have any problems downloading it. And if you are listening to this on YouTube, if you're still listening to this on YouTube, check the links down below. If you have any problems, all you have to do, leave a comment and I will try to get that as quick as I'll try to get those answers as quick as possible. So thank you for listening, everyone. Thank you to Sparse Vector for joining us. Congratulations to those who won a copy of the game, and I will see you all next time here on SS Radio. To those of you sticking around for the live show for Steamy Sundays. I'm going to be covering the final episode of The Walking Dead Season 2 coming up after the break. You will see the stream go down briefly. We're also going to be doing the post-game wagon adventure featuring Sparse Vector and myself, as well as Angelicar. Don't go anywhere, but like I said, before that, you will see the stream go down briefly for about 30 seconds so we can reset the VODs and get that out the door. Again, one last time, thank you all very much for joining me, and I will see you all in just a little bit. Don't go anywhere. You will see the stream go down briefly, and then it will come right back up here on twitch.tv/Invicta. Good night, everybody!